Dear colleagues, I will tell you about the history of this topic, about first multicenter studies, that the results of which were used for developing of modern algorithm of treatment and monitoring. It's a chronic degenerative disease. And as it is, it progresses. Although it's a slow process, nevertheless, it results in irreversible blindness. And we can never know when we see for the first time such a patient what would be the scenario of this progression. Therefore, to provide the best treatment, individualized treatment, it's very important as early as possible to identify the rate of progression in each individual case. So how it all started? Actually, it started in the 60s of the previous century when we started to use static perimetry, SAP, and it was noticed that not in all cases or hypertension will be converted into glaucoma, and not always this disease progresses, hypertension progresses, whilst in normal IOP we can see rapid progression, and we see such works in Sweden, Wales, in the United States, different European countries, and they actually formulated a question, should we really take care of IOP, elevated IOP? Actually, we were shocked because we all knew that we should take care of elevated IOP. And here you see one of the first works telling you that hypertension is not always associated with development of glaucoma. In 90% of glaucoma patients, the IOP is normal. It's normotensive glaucoma. Therefore, we needed multicenter studies, RCTs, so with good infrastructure, with adequate statistics, and you all know these trials. They are listed on this slide, and I want to tell you, such as ocular hypertension treatment, advanced glaucoma intervention, collaborative initial glaucoma, normal tension glaucoma study. So these studies had a control group in their design. It was a control group that were not patients that were not treated. Their glaucoma was not treated. Therefore, it was a unique opportunity to monitor the natural course of the disease and identify all risk factors associated with the progression. So, what these trials demonstrated? The first in the world study of initial glaucoma demonstrated that we should actually take care of elevated IOP, and therefore factors of risk of progression were identified. It's baseline IOP, pseudo-exhalative syndrome, age, bilateral involvement. And there were other risk factors that were associated with glaucoma progression. As again, IOP, optic nerve had hemorrhages, and seeing cornea. But dear colleagues, in this first trial, it was already evident that disease progresses in all patients with cardiovascular diseases. And this progression is associated with perfusion pressure, PP. And from trial to trial, we continue to see such results. It's important, and we are going to listen to an individual lecture to elucidate this factor. You all know trials on ophthalmic hypertension. You know all those factors. Therefore, they were used for the calculate, allowing to calculate the risk of conversion into glaucoma, conversion of hypertension to glaucoma, and therefore should we decrease the IOP, again, age, corneal thickness, etc., all are those important factors. All these trials answered a very important question that was formulated at the very beginning. Should we decrease the elevated IOP? Therefore, there's a postulate that we use today. Each millimeter of decreased IOP decreases the risk of progression by 10 and sometimes even by 19% based on some published data. It was a very important discovery. Therefore, we've learned that we should take care of elevated IOP, increased IOP, but there's always an intrigue. All trials show that groups with progression and group without progression were very similar, actually. Look at the diagrams on the right in the lower. It's normal tension glaucoma. So curves are very close. It's clear that adequate control of IOP is not sufficient to prevent further progression. And from that moment, we changed the monitoring of glaucoma. So it was evident that IOP should be even lower than initially. We're trying to identify target pressure, target IOP. So we realized in each individual case, we should measure their rate of progression. And by that time, we already had algorithm and analysis of events and trends allowed us to calculate numerically the rate of progression. Decibels per year, percentages per year, it was very important because we saw that in the same patient, rate of progression may vary or can vary. The left eye is not progressing and the left eye is progressing. So different treatments should be applied. And it was used for very important purpose. Quickly we calculated and found out that rate of progression is not very high, 0.4 decibel per year. So the risk of blindness is 50 years. In 50 years. If you look at the diagram on the right, you can see that in the majority of patients, we see more than 1 decibel per year. It's a very fast progression, and therefore, the visual function will be preserved for 10 to 15 years, apart from functional tests. We also paid attention on the optic nerve health. Three independent experts assessed, estimated its condition and progression of glaucomatous damage. They noticed that progression is associated with hemorrhages in ONH. And again, from study to study, we saw this statement. Retrospective 10-year analysis from South Korea demonstrates that ONH hemorrhages is almost a unique predictor for the progression of glaucoma, and it was associated with an insufficient decrease of IOP. We know when there's a hemorrhage on ONH, the rate of progression can increase threefold. It's a very important signal to change the strategy. So the rate of progression is used in the equation to calculate the target IOP, and it is used in European recommendations or guidelines on glaucoma management. It is used in clinical trials. You see here Canadian trial. Here you see lower target pressure depending on the rate of progression, although initially it was 18 millimeters baseline. Was 18, but when it was decreased up to 14 millimeters, it is allowed to reduce progression up to 0.11 decibel. Sometimes the disease progresses 0.3 decibels per year. That again, it was demonstrated in RCT with perfect design and perfect monitoring of all patients. Besides, it was demonstrated that different glaucomas progress with different pace. Normal tension progresses threefold slower than pseudofoliative. Normotensive glaucoma. This trial has a control group without treatment. For the first time, it was demonstrated that rate of progression is not associated with IOP, but other factors, risk factors, were identified as well, such as Afro-American ethnic group. In African Americans, glaucoma progressed much more fast than in Asian and European. Hemorrhages, migraine, female gender. All these factors were associated with progression. Lady is normotensive glaucoma. These conclusions were confirmed. And progression was not associated so much as with elevated IOP, but with perfusion pressure, difference between blood pressure and intraocular pressure. And for the first time, it was demonstrated that treatment of glaucoma is associated with the use of antihypertension drugs in patients with low perfusion pressure. Therefore, so I had to answer the question, how to treat glaucoma better? Therefore, we compared surgery, laser treatment, different pharmacotherapies. For the first time, it was demonstrated that pharmacotherapy or surgical treatment did not change rate of progression. Well, advanced glaucoma and the surgery plus laser procedure, it was demonstrated the more a surgeries patient had in his or her history, the faster was the progression. It was a very unfavorable factor. Another important trial or study conducted nowadays, it demonstrated that latanoprost therapy slows down for the progression twofold. Therefore, 10 clinical centers in Great Britain had the first placebo control group for the first time. So it was a control group that was not treated, although patients had glaucoma. They were not treated for 2 years. They were receiving placebo, and only in 1 year, thanks to perimetry, it was established that latanoprost slows down progression twofold. It was clear that other factors are also important. And then again, it's OHN optic nerve head, ONH hemorrhages, retrospective trials at Columbia University and São Paulo University also demonstrated additional factor of the risk of progression, peripapillary choroidea and maximum numbers of peak IOP were also associated with further progression. It's important. Additional factors were evaluated that are associated with fast progression, 1 decibel per year. Same factors, age, corneal thickness, pseudoxylation, hemorrhages, OHN, ONH, hemorrhages, baseline index, and again, 2.3 increased risk in patients with low perfusion pressure, PP. About IOP, Ernest, 2012, analyzed all publications trying to answer the question whether we should reduce IOP, decrease IOP in glaucoma. Out of 412 publications, only a few were changed, and in 65%, it was demonstrated that IOP is associated with progression, but diagram shows it's not always a direct association. There's sometimes indirect association. Therefore, we decided to use better statistical methods. Very interesting trial from Netherlands. All statistical methods were tested, methods used in multicenter studies, and again, new factors were additional or more important factor. It's age, baseline, glaucoma stage, and IOP. Based on these studies, so we concluded these controversial data on progression were mostly associated with statistical method that we used for data processing. And then mathematic modeling were used with the hope that this mathematic model will help us to better prognosticate for the progression. Whilst prognostic activity of these models was not really inspiring. What's important, dear colleagues, we're in a new era of such trials because we have new visualization technique. So we use it for years, but there are no results in the use for assessment of progression rate. OCT helps us to assess the progression, for example. Analysis of events, analysis of trends tell us that in different eyes, rate of progression can be different. You see, multicenter prospective trials that are still ongoing and where these technologies are used. And they already show us importance of the assessment of macular area in progression of glaucoma. Here you see ongoing trials all over the world. And Professor Zangwill will mention these trials from professor from California, CT angiography helps us to visualize the vessels around the disc, ONH, peripapula, retina, and macula area. It's very important because this parameter that characterizes microcirculation, vasculature, microvasculature also help us to evaluate the glaucomatose process. Here you see publication of 2016. It's very important to assess, evaluate perfusion of macular area because this perfusion is altered at the very early stage, pre-perimetric stage, and also CT angiography and electrophysiology studies should be compared. They are very sensitive to dysfunction of ganglion cells. And authors noticed that there is association between OCT angiography, microcirculation, and this association is more associated with the visual field parameters, more associated than with structure. Therefore, OCT angiography can prognosticate thinning of the layer and the fibers, RNFL, and it's a very important prediction factor, prognostication factor. So clinical parameters were assessed and microcirculation parameters shown in red on this slide, alongside with retrobulbar circulation in short ciliary arteries and central retinal artery, have very high predictor activity. They allow prognosticate progression of the disease within the 2 years. It was a prospective study, along with other such as the thickness of RNFL and perfusion pressure. You can see it in the last line. And what's interesting, we actually know for the moment there is a consistency between the density of capillary network. You see it in the lower line with structural changes. You see ganglios complex and visual fields as well, but and moreover. Now we know and we are sure that dropout of capillary network can be seen half a year earlier than other structural changes. Well, structural changes we do not actually see during this time at all, and the visual fields are not changed. So density of capillary network in peripapillary retina, you see it's worsening rapidly during 6 months. All those structural changes are not in place. And there are also cluster changes that are consistent. Yeah. Up hemisphere and dropout of capillary network, twofold decrease of the density of capillary network, and also thinning of RNFL in the same sector is also seen. And the OCT angiography shows parafovea, how rapidly vessels disappear in this macular area. It's also associated with changes in ganglion cells. And new defects in the visual fields, very low at the fixation point. Very interesting analysis, quite recent. Multicenter trials, glaucoma trials, almost 3,000 publications were analyzed, and 103 different prognostic factors were identified for the progression of the disease. Most reliable are the same. It's age, hemorrhages, optic nerve head, baseline parameters, baseline IOP, and pseudo-exfoliative syndrome. We do realize the different data from multicenter trials are explained by the factors that should be taken into account in each individual case. And we probably should speak about specific phenotypes of glaucoma. We know 4 genes that are responsible for 5% of all glaucoma cases. It's clear. The disease progresses depending on inherited risk factors that actually manifest at certain periods of life. And therefore, we are trying to identify the phenotypes based on these factors. So you see 2,000 patients that were analyzed, and 20 loci were identified that are responsible for phenotypes. So, and there's overlaying of these genes, of course, and phenotypes are mentioned here, and Professor Liebner will dwell on this data. So, South California, San Diego University, and you heard the names of people who play very important roles, a coordination center that initiates multicenter studies or trials, and they initiate now very important genetic trial or study in Afro-Americans and Europeans. We know that in Afro-Americans, glaucoma progresses faster, and we'll know the important factors that have influence or impact. So if we take, for example, blood or saliva in patients, biomarkers are important. We are searching for such biomarkers. We already have some potential markers, but we still don't know whether they are associated or not with the progression. Therefore, rate of progression is the key moment in monitoring glaucoma progression. And therefore, to identify it, we have to use all potential structure, function, circulatory parameters, OCT angiography, etc. We know now it's a multifactorial disease. And for personified approach, we should take into account all the phenotypes. And these phenotypes would identify the future of monitoring. And I actually invite all colleagues in the Russian Federation. Please ask your questions. You can provide them in written form at the side of the symposium. And we will have a few minutes after each presentation to answer your questions. And now it's San Diego. Linda Zangwill, I mentioned her today. She actually will not be able to participate in our event personally, but nevertheless, she will tell us what's going on in this university in San Diego in South California.
Dr. Kurysheva, for inviting me to share Dr. Kurysheva за приглашение рассказать о наших исследованиях в центре в нашем университете.
Это мои.
We have several glaucoma clinical longitudinal studies that we are fortunate to be involved with and that are supported by the National Eye Institute, Industry, and Foundations. I want to share some of that work with you and share with you how our clinical research infrastructure has supported these studies. We have the Diagnostic Innovations in Glaucoma Study, or DIGS, what was started in 1995 to look at the new imaging technologies and how that they can be used to help diagnose glaucoma and detect progression. We started with using the Heidelberg retina tomograph, the HRT, moved to time domain OCT, spectral domain, and swept source OCT. Now we're looking at OCTA as well. We recently have been funded to recruit individuals with high myopia to see whether we can use some of these technologies to help differentiate between the high myopes with and without glaucoma. The African Descent and Glaucoma Evaluation Study was started in 2002 to help determine and investigate why individuals of African descent have a higher prevalence of glaucoma and more progression than individuals of European descent. Most recently, we're looking at the lamina and seeing about the biomechanics of the optic nerve head using OCT. With my colleagues from Alabama as co-PIs and Columbia University. The Ocular Hypertensive Treatment Study, you are all probably familiar with, but what you might not know is the 20-year follow-up just finished, and we included OCT in that last patient visit for the study so that we can look at OCT with all the OATS parameters, the data, the quality of life. And we also have some longitudinal data that we were able to get from their clinical tests for their patient management if they were an OATS participant. I'm also looking at the biomechanics of the lamina in relationship to the microvasculature with a grant from the Bright Focus Foundation. And that way we can look at the mechanical and vascular components of the development of glaucoma. For all these studies, it's critical that the clinical research infrastructure is strong. So we have standardized, centralized OCT visual field and data processing at the UCSD reading centers, the VisFact reading center, and the IDEA reading center. I was asked specifically to describe the ADAGES 3 study, where the goal of that study is to identify the genes for primary open-angle glaucoma in African Americans. We have the principal investigators, Bob Weinreb at UCSD and Jerry Rotter at UCLA, and we had directors of the biobanks, genomics, statistics, all involved in the study. We had 5 study centers, and we had a fairly complicated protocol, but with strong study centers, strong coordinators, biobank, data coordinating centers, we were able to have the samples sent to LA, to San Diego, the OCTs, the visual fields, etc. And the fruit of that collaboration are now being seen with several very strong publications where we're starting to elucidate the genetics of glaucoma in the African community. And we have a recent publication in JAMA that just came out showing that variants at the APBB2 locus demonstrated differential association with glaucoma by ancestry. So these are strong, large collaborations with people all over the world. The clinical research infrastructure also facilitates the artificial intelligence strategies and big data analysis that is really driving a lot of some of the new research and new opportunities in ophthalmology. So with our ADAGES and DIGS data, we're able to look at photographs and develop deep learning models that use these photographs that have been graded over the 20 years of DIGS and to see how well they do on photographs that have not been graded. And we found that with moderate to severe glaucoma group, at a high specificity of 90%, the sensitivity was 93%. So we can really detect that moderate to severe glaucoma and perhaps put cameras in primary care clinics or for screening. We're also looking at deep learning approaches using OCT. And we're not just looking at the nerve fiber layer. We're looking at the on-fos nerve fiber of the nerve fiber layer, which looks at the intensity of the voxels of the OCT. We believe that the OCT has a lot of information that is not being exploited yet with the printouts that the clinician sees looking at the nerve fiber layer or the ganglion cell layer. There's a lot more information there that perhaps deep learning and AI algorithms can really learn to use this information in a way that is not being utilized now. We actually found that the on-fos image had the best diagnostic accuracy, even more than a nerve fiber layer map for detecting glaucoma. So I want to thank you for the opportunity to share this information and our glaucoma clinical research at the Hamilton Glaucoma Center.
Very grateful to Professor Linda for this very important comment, dear colleagues. You see how interesting trials are conducted all over the world.